My name is Stefano Babic. I am the author and maintainer for the SW Update project, an over-the-head update agent. And my talk is about delta or incremental update and which open source projects are available to do this. And of course, focus is about SW Update, so which way we have in SW Update to have an incremental update, what we have in the past, but mainly the focus is on the new Delta handler that was introduced with last SW Update release. So first of all, so an overview about SW Update. SW Update is an over update agent. It's integrated into your software, so part of your distribution have a different way to update a system. So as an integrated web server, you can update from a cloud. You have a connection to a fleet management server or a local update. There are security features, so software is signed, can be encrypted, and so on and so on. SW Update is not fixed to a strategy to update the system. One common strategy is called symmetric or sometimes AB or dual copy, and really focus for incremental update is this strategy. So what I will show you is when adapted or is working with an ADB approach. So reason for an incremental update is we have increases signs. Our projects are becoming much more complex. It's common to have software about 100, 150 megabytes. We can reach also a gigabyte of software. Even if our internet connection is very quick sometimes, or at least at home, maybe with fiberglass, there are some devices that work in low bandwidth network like GSM, so 96 kilobit. Even if you have a good connection, you have to put your software somewhere on the cloud, maybe on some service. And when all your devices are starting to update the system, they are generating a lot of traffic. So that means at the end, you have to pay as manufacturer a lot of money to the cloud provider. So reason for updates is as useful as usually is to save cost, so money rules. Different ways in SW Update what we have in the past. For example, we can split between OS and application. So if we provide a different update package, one just for the application, we can have some sort artisanal incremental update. This is because if I update, there's no project where all features are implemented with the first release. So the application is updated much more frequently as the OS. Big issue is the consistency, because you have as a release manager to check that your application, your new application is still compatible with the libraries provided by OS. In SW Update, there's a hooks to provide some consistency, but this is something you have to write your own, so is something project specific. The second one is based on LibreSync. I will say something more. So regarding splitting the party into application and OS update is quite straightforward. In SW description, in SW Update, there's a file called SW description. It's a meta description of the release. You can put here just the application, describe how to install just the application. And of course, this is really project specific. What about if we wanted to update the whole file system? There are some kind of delta. So this was done with a libasync handler. This creates a delta file from a specific version. This is, let's say, the weak part of this handler, because you have to know which is the version running on the device. If you have many devices, you have to provide many delta files. The usage is also quite straightforward. In the stubby description, you add a type for this handler, is RDIF, and you have to put which is the source. So where, on the basis of which part on the running software the delta is applied. There are some drawbacks on this approach. So first of them, so we have the RDIF tool to create the delta, but we need a specific version. And what about if end customer has put a device into closed for 2 years and then is back to the network, should be updated as well. The other big issue is the size of the delta, because using the LibraSync, we have that the size of the delta is increasing, of course, with a number of changes, but there are also a threshold, and after this threshold, the delta is even bigger as the size of the original file to be installed. So the best usage for this handler is if we have frequently updates, we have some kind of rolling release, so we know that all devices are quite with the same version, and we maintain the size of changes small, so we have a small delta. But this is also a reason to try and to find a better approach. So I started from this, and I want to search or to look to some way to find a delta that is independent from the type of sources, because we don't update just software, we update also manual, videos, everything on the devices. So it should be independent. We have embedded device, so that means we cannot use a lot of resources, we cannot use a lot of memory just to apply a delta. And what was important for me is if I have a delta and the resources of the running software on the device, after applying the delta, so I have the new software on the device, this should be identical to what I have built on my system, so in build system. So if I run the hash on the device itself, I should have the same result if I run the result of BitPake. Starting with this, I started to imagine what is the actor involved in this. I can say, well, I have to get something from a server, what is the role of a deployment server. A simple way could be, I have the device sends just the version to a server, the server have all possible version on available, compute the delta based on version or some meta sent by the device, send this delta back, and the device applies. This has a lot of drawbacks. So first of all, the server should have knowledge of a lot of version, and maybe should also know the internals of this version. Second, I have to change something on the server. So if I have a different server, so if I use the Hopi server or use another server, I have a different implementation. So that's very, very bad. And starting from this, we'll start to find a different approach. So what about if this delta is not computed by an external server, but it's computed by the device itself, because the device knows everything from the running software, can compute what is missing, so not really a delta file, but compute what is missing, and downloading what, and downloading just this part. So just comparing the two approach, if I go to a server version, well, I need a lot of files on the server. This can be difficult in some application because, for example, there's a consortium, there's a vendor, there's a consortium for multiple vendors, and it's not allowed to have a lot of files for each vendor. We have to generate files. If we generate something, we have to provide security. So maybe we have to sign these Delta files. And this is also bad because in the approach in SQL data, the server is untrusted. So if there is something, the server is compromised, SQL data detects this and rejects an update. What is as advantages is, of course, the device should do less, and that means the update at the end should be faster as a second approach. But if we run on the device, well, we have independence from the version. Each device will compute maybe a different delta. We have 10 devices with different versions. They have 10 different delta, but at the end, they will go to get the same exact version. We can have then an update from any version to any version. This is very good. We are also running on the device itself, so we have not to send a lot of meta information, because this generates also traffic. So we have not to send a lot of information. We can compute any kind of hashes or whatever on the device itself. Of course, drawbacks, the device has to do something more, so more load on the CPU. Let's say we have a lot of tools in Linux to mitigate this, like Cgroup, NICE, or whatever. But of course, the update will be slower, it's sure. There are some open source projects for Delta. I skip the first one because all of them are required to have to start from a fixed version. I go directly to the CAsync approach because this is more or less in the direction I want to have. But I will say what is good in CAsync and why I cannot use it. So CAsync, this is taken from CAsync website. Good from CAsync. A block device is then, from a block device, it generates a serialized stream. This is very good. In a serialized data, everything is a stream. So this allows me to avoid any temporary copy. So very good. Then CAsync is working with a rolling hash or buzz hash. That means the source is analyzed, split in chunks, and chunks are dynamical, so dynamical sites. A chunk is closed when a pattern is found or when the maximum size of a chunk is reached. So I can split in multiple chunks. That means, for example, if I add something on the etc directory, well, that means that some chunk will be different, but all of the rest will be the same. That's very good. What is doing then CAsync? It's creating what is called a CA index, so with a whole hash of chunks. This is also good because I need then a cryptographic comparison to be sure that what I install is correct. The last part, I say, creates the most of problem because CAsync creates is called CA store, where each chunk is stored on a separate file. And this should be somewhere on the network, on the cloud. I started testing this, and the thing is, when I get each chunk is on a separate file, I need a HTTP GET request for each of them. Sometimes the connection cannot be reused, so for each HTTP GET request, there should be also a new SSL connection and so on and so on. Just checking the number of transfer bytes, so the payload is what CAsync is reporting, but checking on the Ethernet statistic, you can get the whole transfer. You see the overload is very high, so this is very bad, it's not what I want to reach. Not at all, CAsync is a complex and we will see a monolithic project, so it's thought to be used as it is. There's no library, was thought to have a library. There's no authentication, and CAsync is forking itself to download the data from the network. This breaks the security. In established data, there's privilege separation security. So that means that when something should be get from the network, a process with lower priority is started. And this cannot be reached with CAsync. Looking at the drawbacks, I found this other project is Zchunk. It's developed by Jonathan Dieter. He's living here in Ireland. It's used on Fedora project. It's used to download the packages in Fedora. And very interesting, it's using the same approach as a CSync. So it's using chunks, it's using a rolling hash to define chunks of dynamic sites, but it defines a new format that is self-contained. So there's a header with all meta information and there's the chunks. This is much better and fits my use case. More or less interesting is also Jonathan find exactly the same, and I can read from his blog. He also started with CSync, and we both found that CSync is close to what we have to reach, but not exactly what we have to do, because CSync was thought for another use case. Anyway, I have seen, I don't need to start from scratch, but I have to change something in the chunk. Make absolutely sense first to make changes and to push everything to mainline, because nobody wants to work with some fork or something else. So I started to work into the chunk and see what I have to change. So first should be embed-friendly. There's a lot of assertion in the chunk. Well, SWR data cannot be exit, should report runtime errors, and these runtime errors should be evaluated and handled by SWR data. The most important thing is the uncompression hashing, because the chunk just hash the compressed chunk, but on the device, well, I have the rootfs, let's say. So I can evaluate the rootfs, of course it's not compressed, and I can get the chunks and hashes from not compressed data. So I added also meta information for not compressed data, so in the chunk format both are covered. And of course I have to extend the API to make the library, let's say, callable from SWR data. After this, and some, of course, iteration, Jonathan was very kind, merged everything and is in the chunk mainline. Next step, so this is just to say you, so the Z chunk format is just a header and then a list of chunks. There are some other meta information. What is mainly most important for this application is the index. There's a number of chunks. For each chunk, there are hash for both for the compressed chunk and for the uncompressed chunk. Then I have to put this part into SWR. So I have to transfer to the device. Starting from build, I have, let's say, a rootfs. I transform the rootfs in the chunk format. I extract the header, because we have seen the header is just at the beginning of a file. I put the header into the SWU. SWU is the update package for SWR update. That means it's signed. And then I transfer to one of the servers, maybe on the fleet management server. What I also need, because I need to download the missing path, the rootfs in the chunk format will be also put somewhere on the cloud. It can be on the same server, can be also on another server. The only thing should be available to the device via a URL. Connection to SWR data, so everything, so a specific image in SWR data is managed with a handler, so I have to implement a new handler, is a Delta handler. Information for the handler is where I have to install, so the device, where is the source, so where is now the running software, where I get this gchunk format, with gchunk file, so a URL, then each handler is thought to install everything. But if I do this, I had the problem, because if I install on the MMC, it's different if I install on the UBFS, if I install on the NodeFlash, and so on and so on. In SWR data, there's a handler for each of these specific formats. So if I do direct here, I have to redo a lot of things. So the solution here is, if this Delta handler does not install, but create a stream, and everything in SWR data is stream, I can then forward this stream to another handler. So I can have a chained handler, and this stream is then passed to a handle we have already in SWRT, and we can use it with any handle. Also, we can take this stream and send to another device running SWRT, because we have a handle for this. So starting from this, what is happening? So this header is coming on the device. The device is calling via the Zchunk library and creates a header for the running software. I have for the running software header with chunks, for each chunks the hash. I can then make a comparison. So I have a downloading header and a source header. I can just iterate for all chunks for the destination and check, okay, can I find a chunk on the source with these sites and with hash? If I can find it, this is exactly the same chunk and then I can copy. So I have a further structure. This structure will contain also other information like the offset in each of the two files. I can know, I can simply copy or I have to download it. Very good. So that means at this point, I have a way to find a delta on the device itself. I have just to find now how to download the missing path. To do this, the way was via a byte range request. So via HTTP, byte range request. At the end is what we currently do when we see a video on YouTube, we move the cursor, when we want to skip something, is exactly the same. A good thing is, and what is necessary on my use case is that I can put multiple chunks, so multiple bytes request in a single HTTP GET. So I can override the problems I had in CSync. In an idle world, I will say I have just one HTTP GET request, and this contains all chunks I want to download. In the real world, this is not possible, because to avoid denial of service, all web servers or Apache, NGX or whatever have a maximum number of bytes requests to be sent. So that means in my handle I have to split this to create multiple HTTP GET requests. So one when I reach the maximum, I have to create a new one and I have to enqueue all of these requests for the server. What I need from the server is really the chunks, so bytes at the end. The server really answers in this way, so sends partial content, and the answer in partial content as content type is a multi-part byte range. So the last building block I need is really a parser here, so I need to parse all of this stuff and to extract just the chunks. But let's say this complete the number of building blocks I need and can put all together. So the final step is I have this header from the put in the SW, is the new header. I can run the Zchunk library on my source. I have find which chunks are different. I need another actor because the Delta handle is starting to install something. So to maintain privilege separation, I need another process. So there's a downloader, is a servant at the end. So it just get bytes request from the Delta handler and returns the answer from the server or an error if cannot be downloaded. The Delta handler, of course, should synchronize the two stuff, the two stream, and should recreate the new stream. And when it's doing this, we have at this point all hashes. So we hashes for the sources and we hashes from the downloaded. stuff. So all chunks is then verified that the hash is correct. In this way, we exactly know that what we have created at this point, so the created stream, is exactly what we have built on our build server. So running the hash on the build server will produce the same hash we have on the device. The stream, the created stream, will be forwarded to the chain handler. And as I said, when it's generic, I can use any supported handler in SWP data. I can even use a custom handler if someone has a custom handler in Lua. This is also possible because it's a stream and the whole handlers are using stream. That means I can reuse any supported handler. So I mainly used on a couple of projects with MMSC. I know from mailing list someone used with UBFS because I send patches. But you can also use and send to another embedded Linux running SWP data via the SW forwarder handler. So really, you can use all handles we have in SWP update. Just to check to see what's running on the device. If we, of course, we run in verbose mode and we enable what SWP update this handle is doing. SWP update will report for each chunk if the chunk will be downloaded or will be simply copied from the device, and will be reported which is the site from the total site, which is the downloaded site. So you have a feeling about how many bytes were downloaded. The same could be done also at build time, but of course you need to have a starting point. So you need to know which is the starting release. You can use the zchunk tool. There are some extension I have added so to support uncompressed hash and to use the SH256 hash because zchunk as default uses another hash. You create the zchunk format. There's a tool that I've developed. It's not officially in the suite for zchunk, it's in the test directory of zchunk. You can use it. This is doing exactly the same stuff SWPdata is doing. So it's calling the library, reporting back how many chunks were downloaded or were copied, and the total bytes that, if it's running on the device, will be loaded. What is still open? So, as I said, this is a part, was already part of I think in 2021-11, but it's part of a last release, so 2022-5. Mainly was commissioned and was used for Debian. So what is missing is the support in MetaSW update to generate the chunk file to build the header inside the SW. So it's not a lot of stuff, but it's still open. And let's say in this way is already working. I am supposing that in future there will be some optimization. For example, what is happening on the device, the creation of the header from the source takes, of course, a lot of time because the whole software is read. It's read, is analyzed to get the chunk size and to get the hash. This takes a lot of time. Of course, can be a problem when an update is triggered. So another way can be that this is done in advance, for example, when SW update is started and then maintained until an update is triggered. And this can save some time. A bonus of this kind of update is also, let's say that in some way, on your device, something was changed. Maybe file system is starting to be corrupted, or there are some changes due to some bugs in software. That just means that the generation of data on this device is different as on a device that has not this problem. But at the end, we will get exactly for both devices, both will get exactly the same software. So, quite at the end, I want just to say with a summary. So, with this, let's say, delta handler, the chunk handler, is more suitable for a dual copy approach. Good thing is there's no changes on the server side. I have talked previously with Oakbit developers, and they told me, yes, really, we are developing a server for all kinds of devices, so for embedded Linux or microcontroller or whatever, so we cannot implement something that is specific, for example, for embedded Linux, or something that is specific to have a stubby update on board. So they say this should be done outside the server, so this was also an argument against to make something on the server side. What you need is to take this additional file, so for each artifact you want to update with a delta mechanism, you need to store also an additional artifact, but as I say, you can put on the server, on a fleet management server if you have, or anyway on the cloud. The only thing, the device should get access to this file. And of course, you can compare at build time, you can know at build time how many bytes should be downloaded. Okay, so I'm quite, this is my last slide. So I'm ready now for some questions, if you have. Yes?
Could you do some bandwidth comparisons with the other algorithms, like X-Delta or CSE?
Which other?
X-Delta, for instance.
Yes, I did. I was maybe too fast and I skipped, but I did. I checked, for example, X-Delta, I check BSDiff, I check also in Google, it's done for Chromium, you know. So, problem is starting with Google. So, they do an excellent work, but it's really for an ELF file. So, they know they have program, so we download the program, and then we can skip the whole part related to ELF file, because we know it's an ELF file, and then the delta is even lower, so smaller. In my case, does not work because I have a program, I have a configuration file, I have videos, I have something else, so this approach is not working. With X-Delta, my problem is X-Delta, as it is generating or applying the delta in memory. So that means I need a huge amount of memory just to apply the delta. This is not compatible with an embedded device. It's also the reason I change in the chunk how the chunk works. Instead of applying in memory, now it's not applying, it's just writing into a file or writing to the destination. So there's no so much resources required. The main point is really, you see when you run this that it takes a lot of time to calculate the delta. Because the software you run should be read completely, should be read to calculate with chunks. Yes, sorry.
So you're not restricted to a read-only file system?
I'm not restricted, no.
I need an AB,
and of course I'm not restricted, but the problem is if you have a read-write, and when you change the file system, is a problem.
Yeah.
So it can be read-write, But we need also that at least when I compute and then I apply the delta, should be the same.
Yes.
But it's not restricted. As I said, if a file system gets corrupted, it works. Yes.
A question with Z chunk.
Mm-hmm.
Are there pathological cases that will cause it to think that there's more to be updated than really needs to be updated?
So you mean the chunk size?
Yes. So let's say just a few bytes were inserted, and that then causes the hashes to be incorrect if there's not actually much changed.
The way is working is with this Buds hash or rolling hash. It's a mathematical approach. It's also used in a lot of backup programs, really to find just the part change. Think about also on a file system, there's a lot of zeros in the ist4, for example. And what this algorithm is searching is really for pattern. When you find there's a pattern, then it says the chunk is closed. So it can be a very small chunk or a chunk. Here the default, so maximum chunk size is set to 128 kilobyte, the maximum. Is also can be changed, but the thing is that you have to change in G chunk, you can change, you have to change in SWR data as well. So it should be exactly the same. But if you add just a file, you will find that some chunks are changed, and the rest is identical. Yes?
So in case I don't have an over-the-air update, and I do like regular updates using a USB stick, for example, I understood that software updates supports like pre-calculated deltas using librsync. Is that correct?
Using which parsing?
Librsync? Or?
There's something, if it's a local update, you don't need to save bandwidth. So it's quite...
okay, so in my use case, mm-hmm. it's interesting to save bandwidth so that, so I know that the customer has, let's say, version 1.0,
mm-hmm.
customer wants to go to 1.1,
yeah.
the delta is actually small, and I can ship by email, web download, just a
20
megabyte file instead of a 1 gigabyte
file. It's possible, let's say the URL is a URL, so it could be also a URL on a local file. So it can be also used. So you can send the delta plus a small SW, mm-hmm. and the delta, or the file, not really, because the thing is, in your way, is you have defined the delta on the build system at the end. So, and in that case, maybe it's a good thing to use the librsync exactly.
And that's already also...
It's already, yeah.
Great,
so both are available. So both are available. You are the integrator, so you decide yourself if you want to do a major upgrade or you want to do with the chunk. One thing is with difference with librsync. Let's say with librsync, you reach a point where the size of the delta is bigger as this is bad, very bad. With this chunk, the bad case, so the worst case is all chunks are different. And all chunks are compressed with ZST. So also the file I deliver can also be delivered with ZST. So at the end, I have just the sum of chunks and it's quite the same as the whole chunk. So the difference is not so big.
The runtime difference will probably still be...
Time difference, of course. Yeah. Time difference, yes.
Okay.
Yes?
You said the calculation takes quite a lot of time.
compared to just update, yes, yes.
But how much of
a which processor do you have? So I
IMX
cannot
six.
Do IMX6, so I have tested with IMX6, but depends when from your delta. If the download depends from the delta, so depends from the size of the Wi-Fi system. I cannot say. The only thing you have to imagine, the whole file system should be red. This is the difference. Takes time. You can just make a DD on your device and see, reading the whole file system, you already know. When there's the running of a rolling hash, takes some time. Now, I have no idea now really which part, but the major part is reading back all your software.
Not calculated.
Let's say no calculated, or for a specific project must be tested, yes. Depends if it's an issue. In most cases, it's not an issue, because it's with an AB approach, so it's running in background, and if it takes more minutes, even more, does not matter. So I don't know if a VS project requires really that it's going fast. This is top, I think, so yes. So was the last one.